'Cause a fire on the street is like a fire in the heart. Don't you know? We could start on any street in any town, and any state if any clown decides that now's the time to fight for some ideal he thinks is right. And if a million more agree, there ain't no great society as it applies to you and me. This fucking country isn't free if all that you
can ever be. Le quartier où l'aventure hippie a commencé est devenu la vitrine du peace and love. Aujourd'hui, des colliers de perles et des posters psychédéliques ne sont plus que l'écume asséchée de la vague contestataire qui a secoué l'Amérique des années 60. Des milliers de zen débarquent à San Francisco à la recherche d'une autre vie, à la poursuite d'un vague mirage de paix et d'amour.
Oh, encore une histoire de hippie.
Mais non, justement. Écoutez la légende des Diggers qui ont bousculé ses enfants frères.
Oublie la guerre du Vietnam et viens prendre ton premier acide.
Pendant que les hippies ouvrent les portes de la perception, de l'autre côté de la baie, les étudiants de l'université de Berkeley se radicalisent. Ils s'opposent à la guerre du Vietnam, veulent en finir avec l'Amérique puritaine des années 50 et soutiennent le mouvement des Noirs.
We are on the move for our liberation.
Oublie les discours politiques de la New Left, la lutte des Noirs, et va danser sur la musique psychédélique. Tu es libre, libre d'oublier, alors oublie. Suis la mode, les boutiques hippies et les marchands de la nouvelle conscience. Ils t'attendent, ne redescends sur terre que pour baiser et manger. Finalement, ta conscience en expansion n'est qu'une vision de hippie égoïste qui embrasse le cul du système et se glorifie d'abandonner la lutte pour des délires solitaires sous acide.
Les Diggers. Un nom de guerre, une signature anonyme, une identité collective derrière laquelle se cache une douzaine de furieux impatients. Ils veulent vivre, tout de suite, comme si la révolution était déjà gagnée. Ils dénoncent le commerce des marchands hippies, crachent sur la récupération des médias et jouent leur vie à fond pour mettre en scène la commune libre de Etchebury. Les Diggers se sont rencontrés dans la même troupe de San Francisco, une compagnie de théâtre anti-establishment fondée en 1964 par Ron Davis. Ron Davis choisit d'aller vers le public plutôt que de l'attendre. Il reprend la forme parodique de la Commedia dell'arte et fait jouer sa troupe gratuitement dans les parcs.
You must have some money, children. Have some money, after all, money must be spent.
If there were no money, there'd be no rich. If there's no rich, there'd be no poor. No poor, there'd be no debt. No debt, no installment buying. Expense of money.
And I'd say the combination of the political insight with the comic and the commedia and the outdoors was concurrent with the whole social movement, starting an anti-war movement. I mean, we were there, and they were there, and we sort of joined, and they joined us, and we marched along, and all of a sudden became part of this new left, post-beatnik. I became more part of the new left, post-beatnik, hippie and yippie, and then eventually digger event.
Out of flu, 17 sheriffs was after me. Ooh. One part of Canada.
The argument was you can't quite be non-racist in a racist country. That's the problem. And if you want to be non-racist, well, then you have to change the whole thing around.
This country has done so much running away from itself that it's going to wind up just going into a circle. It's in a circle of madness until it finally is flipped totally out. Because there are so many things that we're trying to pretend aren't there. And we all know they are.
Well, look at the kids, man. There are 500 runaways a month coming to San Francisco and living in the streets.
And, you know, a kid's going to come and live in the streets, 500 a month. It must mean that something's wrong with middle-class America. Something's wrong with America, period. And the kids know it. The hippies know it. The straight people know it, right? Okay? It's just that some people think it's worth it to give up the money or to give up the status or to give up whatever it is that they know is hanging them up. Now people want to be free of all this. Yeah, people are tired. And I don't know. I'm just hoping that something's going to happen soon. Something good for everybody.
Because we're face to face with it every day. You don't like the way the system is out there, try and change it. You're frustrated because you're trying to do something you want to do. You're trying to spread a little joy, a little life, a little understanding, a little dialogue, possibly a little love, a lot of hate. But in order to do that, you got to struggle through a whole bunch of backwash of garbage that's thrust in your face every day with newspapers and radio. And one of the problems with the stuff we do is it brings up all the garbage.
So we went to the park with these platforms. So we talked to the police, and they said, well, if you unload the platform, you'll get arrested. I said, no, we don't want to get arrested for unloading the platform. I said, well, who will get arrested? He said, the first person who opens their mouth, et cetera, will get arrested. And I said, okay. So we talked about that. We talked to the audience, and then I said, okay, we don't want to unload the platform. That's silly, because that won't be good. I said, okay, I will do the opening of the show, and I'll say what I'm going to say. I'll say it here. I said, the way I used to open the show was where I'd come on, we'd play some music. And then we'd do some music, we'd do around, and I would say, Madame, Monsieur, and Mademoiselle, ladies and gentlemen. So, Senor, Senora, Senorina, Madame, Monsieur, and Mademoiselle, ladies and gentlemen, Il Truppo di Mimo present for your appreciation today an arrest. And at that moment, comes the cop, and he arrests me. And ultimately, it's appropriate for me to get arrested and no one else, rather than I'm the head of the troop, I can blah, blah, blah. And it's symbolic. It's a symbolic arrest anyway. It's not a major crime that we're doing. We're not going to be thrown. I'm not going to be thrown in jail forever. It's a socio-political issue, a cultural one.
When this play was stopped, I realized that all the rehearsal of the play, all the writing of it, all the costumes, were just to prepare the event to be a different kind of theater that you could call police theater, or you could call it guerrilla theater. The term guerrilla theater is my term, and I used it to describe that kind of event. So the real theater there wasn't the rehearsal and the play and the rest of it. The real theater was to perform this illegal act in front of people who would participate in the whole event. The event was the arrest. It was one of the beginning events of the movement of the New Left in San Francisco, the political 60s.
En automne 66, la communauté noire se révolte. Regarder la rue s'enflammer donne à Emmett Croghan et Billy Murcutt des envies de théâtre encore plus radicales que celui qu'ils font dans la même troupe. Inspiré par les digueurs anglais du XVIIe siècle, un groupe de paysans qui s'était approprié les terres royales pour nourrir le peuple, il décide d'agir sous le même nom, quitte la mine troupe et placarde sous ses portes un manifesto.
This manifesto was really wonderful. It was it had a list of about 40 things, as I recall. I'm not positive. And it said, fuck this, fuck that, fuck the government, fuck the mayor, fuck the police. And the last one was, fuck the meme troop.
Was it important for them to leave the meme troop? Yes. Obviously, they thought the action, the revolution, and their activity and their activism was in Haight-Ashbury. That's what I was told. We're going to work on the streets. Okay, go. Goodbye.
There was this tremendous energy on the street, and it was almost... In some ways, it was compelling. It seemed almost a compromise, or less important, let us say, to perform in a show than to be out on the street performing in whatever way you were performing. And we were doing outrageous things in the streets.
Avec le théâtre comme arme de combat, les digueurs descendent de scène et s'approprient la rue. Là, on les attend déjà. Artistes en colère, poètes, fugueux en moto, voleurs de viande, tous les agitateurs de l'imagination, tous ceux pour qui l'aventure des enfants fleurs paraît trop rose.
We wanted to cut through the knot and act. And an act explains itself. We tried not to have ideologies. That's why the diggers could never be infiltrated. That's why there were never any agents, because there was no structure. There was no leader. There was no ideology except do your thing. Do it anonymously and do it for free.
La plupart des jeunes qui débarquaient à Haight-Ashbury étaient dans la dèche et on ne voyait pas ce qu'il y avait de si cool là-dedans et en quoi faire la manche était particulièrement jouissif. Alors pour en finir avec cette mouise et éveiller tous ces jeunes à une conscience sociale collective, on a pensé au repas gratuit.
There was a rally and we went to this rally and Emmett was speaking at the rally. And this was in the fall of 1966. And we met him after the rally, and he said, want to cook? And that's how it started. We cooked.
Boy, I did so much cooking sometimes. Everybody did. I mean, it was a lot of work to it all, but it was good-hearted. We some of it was insane. Most of it was legal.
And San Francisco is a produce market. Every city has that. And we'd go to the produce market and ask the people for food. And whatever they didn't think that they could sell, they would give.
Ripe potatoes.
Howdy, brother.
And sweet
tomatoes.
And there was some broccoli, and there was some chicken wings, and there were yams and potatoes and squash and everything. The truck would scarcely move. It was so filled with food, and we just wallowed out and struggled back up the hill to our little house on Noe Street, and I got out of the truck, and Brooks was there, and he went, good work, you got the free food, you can go to sleep now, and I'll see you at 4:00.
I woke up in the morning to a rooster crowing in my house. And sometime in the night, Emmett had come, and I think Kent had something to do with this, too, and had brought these chickens, in which they were then going to slaughter and put into the day's soup.
The first time we made food in the park, the place where we made it was near the Haight-Ashbury, but we chose the place because in the morning and afternoon, cars went by of people going to work. So we not only made a dairy can, milk can full of stew and served it free to people. but we did it inside a frame that was 12 feet by 12 feet. A very big frame. You know, a frame this size. Painted orange. So you couldn't miss it. You could not miss this thing. So if you were in a car, what you saw was a painting of people in the park having free food. And the reason we did this was because John Cage had said, if you put a frame around anything, it is art. And because we said that when you did things free, you were doing it in a free frame of reference.
But the free food was like kind of like the defining event, because it was a form of taking responsibility for the manifestations of our life and our culture. It was like saying we're a distinct people and we're going to try to help take care of our people. And what the and so we became willy-nilly sort of free frame social workers, although the joy in the process was always a critical element of it. I mean, we were never do-gooders in the sense that we were depriving ourselves of a good time.
Basically, we provided food so that people could have a free life. I mean, so that you wouldn't really need to go to work or do things, and you would have houses that you would say have a sign that had diggers welcome in, and people would just come and sleep there. Sometimes you didn't even know who would wake up in bed with you. Because, I mean, not as a lover, just somebody crashing.
Mutualism, sharing, all of those ideas are corrupted when the only basis for the social contract is money. So an alternative to money is a necessary and good thing, in my mind. And how to bring that about, it was obvious to me that we couldn't get from money to no money without a step in between. So in the revolution to create a mutualistic society, there had to be an introduction of this idea. And all of the, from my perspective, all of the digger-do, I called it, the digger-do, was to create this perspective, to raise consciousness about other values than values having to do with money and a different social contract. So our motto is everything is free, do your own thing. And everything is free there means doesn't cost anything. And do your own thing is be free, practice freedom.
Pour répandre leurs idées, les diggers distribuent dans les rues des tracts, des appels anonymes à la subversion, comme les poèmes de Richard Brodigan, la recette du cocktail Molotov ou l'annonce des repas servis dans le parc.
The free news was filled with the kind of wild, semi-apocalyptic machismo spirit. Here's Antonin Artaud. This is something that Emmett did. Here's a poem, sort of, by Peter Berg. Daytime paranoia becomes a joke at night.
It was news of the imagination. It never tried to be objective news of the real world. There was no difference made between writing down a story of somebody's ideal afternoon and the story of what actually happened objectively in the street. And the medium itself was ephemeral. It would be printed in a matter of hours, distributed in a matter of two more hours. For me, it was a pleasure to see these street sheets blowing down the gutter.
If you can do what you do and give it away free, then you don't want credit for it. And that was a statement. It was a statement to put something on the street that was beautifully written and inspirational and wasn't signed.
La gourmandise rend l'argent plus important qu'il n'est et le transforme en but, alors qu'il n'est qu'un outil. L'argent est juste un autre moyen de communication, une autre forme d'énergie. L'énergie doit circuler. Si tu la retiens, elle te brûle.
People with a large coffin walk down the street in huge animal heads with huge pieces of money in the coffin. So these animals were going down the sidewalk. Get out my life, why don't you, babe?
When the police arrested four puppets and four guys and let the guys out of jail and kept the puppets in jail, they didn't know what they were doing. They didn't understand it, but they knew there was something wrong about it, that they were supposed to protect the rest of society against it.
And when you've got as many people as were in the Haight-Ashbury at that time, you could make a riot start. People would flow out into the street enjoying this, participating in this, but the traffic would stop.
It wasn't that we created riots. It's that we liberated the area. We liberated the Haight-Ashbury and let people do whatever they wanted to do. It was actually free hate. It was free hate.
I think my perception was we would never have a chance like this again. I thought what was happening in the Haight-Ashbury was not only revolutionary in ideas and behavior, but it was an actual physical movement of people. This was like the anarchists taking over the Heights, but the sidewalks were like six people deep on both sides of the street, of people just walking, grinning, smoking marijuana, playing music. And if we said there was going to be an event in the park, and we often did say this, 5,000 people, I'm serious, 5 to 10,000 people would come just based on a piece of paper that we handed out in the street in the morning. By noon, they would be there.
But the idea of a Diggerly Do was that there was no division between actors and audience. Everybody just got together and did it. And if there was any leadership, it was that some people thought it up, but as soon as anybody, any fool on the street could participate. So as soon as you did something, whatever people did with it, well, that was the play or that was the event. And I remember one time
there was a whale that had been killed by some government agency. And they actually called the diggers to say, we have, 500 pounds of whale meat. So we said, okay, we'll have an event. We'll call it Whale Meat. W-A-I-L, whale. Woo! Whale meat. And whale meat. Meet together with whales.
And I think it was Emmett who had the great idea to deliver a truckload of snow. And he had gone to the San Francisco Ice Company, and he had gotten this snow that I guess they get by cleaning out their refrigerator coils or something. And he had a whole pickup truck load full of snow, and he drove it onto the field, and the snow was pushed out. So there was a huge pile of snow there.
And they made snowballs and threw snowballs back and forth over this two-story construction in the park. That was one of the things that was going on that day. I asked her, Lenore, if you did something in the park, what would you do? And she said, I'd make little places for people to make love all over the park. We took the whale meat and cut it into slabs, made an enormous barbecue pit, and barbecued the whale meat in the park while the snowballs were flying on the scaffolding and the people were making love in the bushes. And a man ran naked through the crowd, throwing cards that said, be free, It's just, if you looked at this, it was like a complete revelation of the new world, or a world uninhibited world, a world no one had ever seen. You could not see something like this and not be affected by it. You know, well, some people just stared, you know, but we never knew whether they were staring because they didn't understand it or they were so loaded. You know, they had taken so much LSD, they just couldn't move.
We life acted what it would be like if you could live in a free society. If you lived in a society where the decisions you made were what you wanted to do. If you could live from... It was actually quite existentialist. Because we were thinking of doing things within the time frame of now and living it to the fullest extent you could, as beautifully as you could, as excitingly and creative, as exciting and creatively as you could live life. Let's do it and see what happens.
Les Diggers ouvrent des magasins gratuits, lieux d'échange et de vie où l'on vient s'habiller, se nourrir, se loger et même se faire soigner. Mais c'est avant tout une nouvelle scène pour leur théâtre guérilla.
The Diggers are hip to property.
Les Diggers s'affranchissent de la propriété privée. Tout est libre et gratuit. Choisis ton action. Les êtres humains sont les véhicules de l'échange. Nourriture, machines, vêtements, matières premières, toits et accessoires sont là disponibles. Objet. Le détaillant idéal serait un distributeur automatique à ciel ouvert. Les serrures sont chronovores. Combinaisons sont autant d'horloges. De sorte qu'un magasin gratuit, qu'une clinique ou qu'un restaurant gratuit sont une forme d'art social. Un théâtre sans billets, exonéré, sans argent ni contrôle. Les Diggers ouvrent des magasins gratuits pour émanciper la nature humaine. Libérons d'abord l'espace, les biens et les services. Que les théories économiques se plient enfin aux faits sociaux. Une fois ouvert, un magasin gratuit, désir, don, besoin et appropriation se prêtent largement à l'improvisation. Un panneau. Si quelqu'un demande à voir le directeur, répondez-lui qu'il est le directeur. Une corbeille porte les critos, argent gratuit, ni propriétaire, ni gérant, ni employé, ni caisse enregistreuse. Le vendeur d'un magasin gratuit est un acteur de vie.
And it hit me, you know, this is life acting, is you create the condition you describe. And if we're lucky, the condition lasts for a long time. And if it isn't, well, at least we tried. And there were people that didn't get it. I mean, there were people that you would give free money to, and they wouldn't get it. Or sometimes social critics said we were Robin Hoods, that we were taking from the rich and giving to the poor. That isn't what we were doing. I mean, we got things from all sorts of sources, and that was magical. But what we did with it was to create a theater that described everything being free, hoping that that would lead to a social movement.
When they emerged in the Haight-Ashbury in the fall of 1966, they saw themselves as situated between the New Left, which was very strong in the Bay Area, not only in Berkeley, but also in San Francisco. But they did not consider themselves hippies, although they lived among the hippies. They did not think that the hippies had any kind of a program that would bring about long-lasting changes, even though they sympathized with some of the practices of the hippies, including the use of psychedelic drugs to disrupt the conditioning of the dominant culture.
LSD, peyote, champignons, les drogues hallucinogènes font flasher des milliers de jeunes. Elles ouvrent les portes de la perception, aident à transcender la pensée ordinaire, à explorer l'inconscient. Pour certains, c'est une expérience quasi religieuse qui a ses gourous. Timothy Leary, le pape du LSD, et Ken Kesey, organisateur des acid tests. La révolution psychédélique bouleverse la peinture, la musique, la littérature et l'ordre du monde.
And psychedelics certainly opened up the world and made people see things in a very, very different way. To me, the most important LSD trips I ever took were the first two or three. That's where you really got an idea of, wow, the world is not the way I've been taught at all. But then the trick was to learn how to do it without the drugs. That's taken a long time.
I remember a big moment for me was I was sitting at this desk I had in the Mime Troupe office as the publicity director, and Emmett walked by. Emmett Grogan walked by and says, "Hey, here's a beer. You want a beer?" I said, "Sure." I took the beer, and I noticed the cap came off a little loose. This was should have been an indication. But I drank the beer, and about 15 minutes later, everything started feeling strange, you know, and I started kind of trembling, and my skin was feeling odd, and I didn't know quite what was going on. And I just let go. And I didn't realize until sometime later that I'd been dosed with LSD, but I believe that was the time we were having a party at Schrader Street. And I think that was maybe the night that Jane and I actually got together. Fortunately, we managed to pull out before we got too deep into any kind of dangerous drugs, but we used to, you know, in the old days, we would take LSD, Jane and I, as a matter of course, two or three times a week, and just go out into the streets. That's what you did. You didn't, you know, go to the country and wait for a beautiful, quiet, peaceful moment. You took LSD and you ran right out into the streets for the action, whatever it may be.
It didn't change my life, no. But my life, I mean, I'd already been involved in sitting zazen and stuff like that. I mean, I'd already been doing a lot of interior searching and facing, so I wasn't a shock to me. People that lied to themselves about themselves got into a lot of trouble with it. Personally, I think it's worth it, because I wouldn't want to live without knowing who I was or hiding from myself, and unfortunately a lot of people do. I don't think that's a solution to anything. I don't know that psychedelics is a necessary part of it. For some people, it opened up their lives. For some people, it didn't. I had found my revelations in other directions.
There was always a sort of ongoing conflict between the Diggers and the Oracle, because the Oracle sort of stood for the visionary, psychedelic, meditative, philosophical aspect of the culture. And the Diggers were concerned with how do you live day to day? How do you get your food? How do you survive in a culture that's gone mad? And how do you survive from bad trips and bad drugs? And where do you live? And so on. So we really were complementary aspects of the culture, but there was some conflict between us.
We definitely were something different than that. We were not simply celebrating, you know, the religious experience of LSD. We were trying to build the, you know, cultural infrastructure, as it were, upon which could become the launching pad for a new way of life.
We knew that the media had convinced the entire American population under 30. That San Francisco was the place to go. We knew this in January. And we decided that this was an opportunity to have an anarchist theater university of the streets. That if we could attack people's consciousness when they came, that when they left, because we knew that they would leave, when they went back, they would take something of the experience that they'd had in the Haight-Ashbury.
Their formulation was that the culture was the base and everything else was built on that. And with this analysis, you should not worry about changing the politics, because if you change the culture, the politics would change along with that. So they thought that it would be possible to radicalize the hippies in a way that would create another force for change, but to change the culture, and along with that, then the assumption that the politics would change also. So they were not hippies, and they were not members of the New Left. They represented a new force in 60s youth culture at that time.
Thank you.
been held. And we felt that that was something of a big media event. And the Diggers wanted to throw a party for San Francisco to show how different things could be. We didn't like the fact that at the be-in, there was this stage and there were stars on the stage and the people were separated from the stars. But the Diggers wanted to plan a party where there would be kind of no separation between the people throwing the party and the people coming to the party. And took over this church and we called a big meeting and got a bunch of friends together and everyone started throwing out ideas.
And the first thing that happened was the Invisible Circus. It was Peter Coyote, I think, that first called me to attend a meeting of the Artists' Liberation Front. And Bill Fritch and I went and immediately became involved with everybody and with the Invisible Circus, which was... a manifestation of both the hidden and overt minds of the people of the time, which encompassed an incredible variety of unbelievable actions. Everybody took different rooms of the church and developed their fantasies. Peter Berg and I worked on one room together.
Incense was burning, and there were incense burning everywhere, and people were taking their clothes off and dancing wildly on the pews and on stage, and then people were having sex at the back of the stage, and it turned into a sort of an orgy.
It was incredible. Sweat was flying through the air, clothes were vanishing. It was so crowded you couldn't breathe. Police and reporters that happened to come by any of it just left. They couldn't face it. It was too much for anybody to believe was really happening.
We had a rather well-known sex educationalist giving a lecture on, liberated sexuality, but a very sort of academic lecture. And the woman who was giving the lecture had no idea that there was a sheet hung behind her that kind of separated from the rest of the room. And one of the Diggers, whose name need not be mentioned, was hiding behind the sheet. And there was a little hole in the sheet, and periodically, about every 3 to 5 minutes, he would put his penis out through the hole in the sheet until the whole classroom noticed it. And this woman never knew what was happening. She went on with her lecture about sexual liberation. So that kind of thing. Forgive me. Anyway.
There are no ways of love but beautiful. I love you, all of them. I love you. Your cock in my hand stirs like a bird in my fingers. As you swell and grow hard in my hand, forcing my fingers open with your rigid strength, you are beautiful. You are beautiful. You are 100 times beautiful. I stroke you with my loving hands, pink-nailed long fingers. I caress you. I adore you. My fingertips, my palms. Your cock rises and throbs in my hands, a revelation, as Aphrodite knew it. There was a time when gods were purer. I can recall nights among the honeysuckle, our juices sweeter than honey. We were the temple and the god entire. Our bodies move and join unbearably. Your face above me is the face of all the gods and beautiful demons. Your eyes. Love? Touch is love. The temple and the god are one. Eh bien?
I love it.
It's love poems that had a very strange effect. since they were arrested by the police. And there was a trial. It lasted, I don't know, either 2.5 weeks or 5.5 weeks or something very long. And it was mainly religious because it was considered blasphemous. They also got very upset at speaking about sex openly and that a woman should speak about sex openly and about enjoying it. Thanks to the police force of San Francisco. Became a very well-known poem, and a lot of people learned a lot and got freed a lot from it, because a lot of people, it seems, had the same feelings but not the language, and enjoyed being able to present the languages, including a lot of women who were able to present this as their feelings. So it did a lot of freeing.
Les fans ligueurs descendent dans les rues, invitent les hommes d'affaires à prendre leur journée et les rejoignent sur l'étage bleu.
Threads of revolution at that period. The Black Panthers were in Oakland. The New Left Radicals were on the campuses. The War Resisters were a group. The Civil Rights people were a group. Black Freedom people. So did we think there was a revolution? Yes, there was a revolution in progress. Were the Diggers part of that? Definitely part of it. And if we had our way, we wanted to infuse the rest of it with the same idea.
Les mauvais trips, les maladies vénériennes et la malnutrition inquiètent le jeune docteur David Smith. Il s'inspire des soins gratuits du Free Store et ouvre en juin 67 la Etagebury Free Clinic qui existe toujours aujourd'hui.
So the Diggers set the philosophical tone. It was absolutely fascinating to watch him and hear him speak. They would give talks and pass out the food and present their philosophy and, you know, many of us, including myself, had never heard of a philosophy like that. And it was a very interesting experience. It certainly changed my life. And free was not just an economic term. We didn't charge at the point of liberty of care, but it was also a philosophical term, free of bureaucratic alliances. Our philosophy was health care is a right, not a privilege, which in the United States is at that time was a very controversial and radical statement because we don't have a national health insurance plan. We still don't.
This is the Digger poster, and it was made to be put up on the side of banks, freeway entrances, all over the Haight-Ashbury and other parts of San Francisco. The symbol up in the corner is from the I Ching, and it's the symbol for revolution. And this is the Digger theme was 1% free, which meant two things, that 1% of the people were ready to be actually free, and the other that 1% of everything everybody did should be free, at least 1%. When I showed this poster to the hip merchants in Haight-Ashbury, they immediately assumed that it meant I wanted 1% of their money to support the free store. And I let a couple of them believe that because we got our rent from the free store from the hip merchants.
Pendant que les diggers diffusent leur idéologie du free à toute la ville, les médias, eux, ne parlent que de love.
When they hated independent proprietors, these guys were making money, you know, the Oracle, and when all these guys said, a summer of love in San Francisco, we invite you all, you poor, you know, runaways, you poor repressed young people, come to San Francisco. In San Francisco, we will achieve eternity together, you know. People actually believed that there was going to be some kind of celestial explosion and that we're going to all be transported to a higher level and that none of the old stuff mattered.
And of course, they weren't thinking of all at all of any of the infrastructure or what would happen with these kids when they got here. And beside ourselves, we also provided lodging. I mean, my door was never locked, and I would wake up in the morning with 10 or 15 strangers sleeping on our floor.
En déclarant l'été de l'amour, les médias ont fait des enfants fleurs une figure à la mode. Les plastiques hippies débarquent.
The anonymity was to not give interviews to the media at all. We never were interviewed by the media because the media puts its own frame of reference.
We could give you a nice setup like this, the whole thing, for around $100. That's beard, mustache, wig, and you're all ready to be a weekend hippie.
And so it is in our society. Nothing is, as it seems. Even the hippies of Haight-Ashbury may be working on Montgomery Street during the week and look more like this. This is Jim Anderson reporting.
Aujourd'hui, le hippie se dépouille de ses perles et devient un homme libre. Le fils chéri des médias est mort.
The hippie phenomenon became too much. It was clear that we were that so much fun, that so many having so much fun could not be allowed to continue to do so. And by early 1967, of course, the Haight-Ashbury was famous. The press had, you know, made the hippie famous.
And the nature of the Haight-Ashbury began to change. The bloom was off the rose. More hard drugs started coming in. Fewer people were coming in. More were just homeless on the streets. The energy was shifting from being a joyous, revolutionary energy to being a repressed.
Hey, vous allez en Californie?
Bien sûr, petite, monte! Et regardez ce que j'ai dégoté!
Tiens, prends de l'héro et de l'acide.
Je connais un mec qui serait prêt à loger $20 pour te sauter, mignon.
T'arrêtes pas 45 dollars pour qu'on aille acheter de l'héro?
Mon cœur s'est arrêté.
$400 pour rentrer à la maison, pour que je vois mon docteur et mon psy.
Well, Ed, the first thing you're going to notice when you drive down Haight Street is a difference in the people. The flower children aren't here anymore. The flower children that began this whole scene. If you look around, you can see these are not flower children.
Who are they?
Well, they're a different element. They still dress in the typical garb of the hippie, but they're a different element now. They're a hoodlum type, criminal type, taking advantage of the scene.
flower not only is wilted, it's dead. Ed Arnold for Eyewitness News in San Francisco's Haight-Ashbury.
And it took us a little while to realize that. Nobody quite wanted to let go because it had been such a great couple years.
We held City Hall steps as a free space for 3 months. And every day we read poetry, gave away food, did theater.
Acting out freedom for the bureaucrats, basically, who were coming in and up and down the City Hall steps every day at that time. Engaging them directly, face to face, as well as reading poetry to them. And it was a lot of fun.
Which one?
It was just fun to do this.
Guitar player.
The
guitar player?
Yes. He's a creep. He's a creep.
Why is he a creep? Because he has to work. Free work.
He's not working. You're not working. Nobody.
Are you working?
We decided to do that to take the digger energy out of the Haight-Ashbury and spread it through the city. We did events on City Hall steps, but we also did them in all the different districts of the city. Rock concerts, free food events, art events.
Who am I? Am I a wage laborer? Am I an IBM?
I felt it was very important not to be academic, not to live in a world apart from everybody else, not to play back and forth between people who already agreed with you, but to sort of shine out everywhere.
And it freed people up to simply go out and into the streets of the city and do their acts more publicly.
And there was also then an attempt to have connections to, like, the Panthers and other groups in the city, you know, to have, in terms of a bigger free city, to have more connection to all the other different groups that were going on.
So I think the evolution from digger to free city was simply the growth of an idea, or began to seem possible that this was, you know, that we were actually inventing a structure that would be available to everyone. Mm-hmm. Emmett wrote that all out, basically, in the Digger papers, in the, what did he call it, the Free City Collective.
Notre système industriel est capable de nourrir tout le monde s'il s'organise dans ce but. Mais ne l'attendons pas. Il est temps de nous atteler à la tâche, de créer des villes libres dans l'actuel environnement urbain du monde occidental. Notre lucidité exige que nous amplifions nos efforts pour échapper à la compétitivité. Les villes libres sont constituées de tribus comme les Black Panthers, les Provo et autres gangs, et communes révolutionnaires qui organisent des services chargés de fournir une base de liberté à tout groupe autonome désirant mener à bien son projet. Tout frère et sœur devra pouvoir disposer gratuitement de ce dont il a besoin. Nourriture, hébergement, habillement, publication, transport, aide médicale et juridique, éducation.
In 1968, I read the Digger papers, and this is the issue that I found on the newsstand, and you can see where it's folded over. I folded it, put it in my back pocket, and started coming across country to San Francisco to find out what the Diggers were all about. So it became a quest for me when I was 16 years old. My collection, ever since then, I've been collecting about the Diggers, and eventually lived in a commune that had been an offshoot of the Digger movement. Everything was free. They practiced the Digger philosophy of free.
The Diggers I knew about in a kind of very casual way. No one really knew exactly who they were or where what was going on. But I was very impressed with the things that I had read and seen about them. And when I met Phyllis and was introduced to all these people, it seemed like a natural. Plus, I think I needed a place to live at the moment. And so that was very easy because you could always stay for dinner and then for the rest of your life if you wanted to. So, and that became very exciting to be involved in what these people were doing.
I can paralyze a 200-pound attacker with just a finger, because I know the
last. Oh, being a digger was a trip, and people would get on the digger trip, and they would stay on it for a while, or they would stay on it for a long time. and or as long as they wanted to. So somebody could be a digger for a day, and that would have been it. We didn't really have an organization. We didn't count people.
I have no way of knowing how many diggers there were. Anybody who called themselves a digger was a digger. There were diggers that I never knew. There were diggers in other cities. There were diggers in San Francisco I never knew. So that was one of the beauties of it. It was open-ended.
Les diggers ont servi des repas tous les jours aux jeunes de la Love Generation. Ils ont organisé une infrastructure pour les accueillir, pour les soigner. Leur action radicale attire l'attention. Les médias s'empressent de les cataloguer. Ce sont des Robins des Bois, l'armée du salut des hippies. Leur nom est utilisé dès que le mot free apparaît. Free ne veut plus rien dire.
A group of hippies called the Diggers have decided to plant tomatoes round the trees to beautify the street and grow their own food.
For most people, it was very confusing because so much activity had gone into creating the Diggers that they didn't know what to do next. And people were asking me, what should we do now? And I said, what would you like to do? Meaning, let's go on and decide what the next evolutionary step will be. And for some people, it meant going to the country. For some people, it meant dropping out of the digger thing and being on drugs for a long period of time. For some people, it was to make a caravan and go across the country, spreading the digger idea in various places. What happened, though, over time, was that the people that kept doing it became a large family. And as a family, they began supporting each other. That group of people was a couple of hundred.
I'm going up the country, baby, don't you wanna go? I'm going up the country, baby, don't you wanna go? I'm going to some place where I've never been before. I'm going where the water tastes like wine. I'm going where the water tastes like wine. We can jump in the water, stay drunk all the time.
The Red House is in Forest Knolls. We're Ron and Marcia Thalen. We're living. Because it was in Marin County and not very far from San Francisco, people traveled, came by all the time. It was like living in a party, a constant party. And I had my baby in a party, basically. I was young. I knew nothing about taking care of babies, but I had women who were older than me who helped me learn how to take care of babies. At the peak of the time with the most people, maybe 50 people were living there. And we have 12 babies in diapers. And and so there were many different households that all felt like they were part of the same family, like the Black Bear place in Olema and people in San Francisco. And then people would just move and set up a household somewhere. So there was a constant kind of movement of all these people who lived in different places.
Well, we traveled to help one another. We delivered food and goods to other communes. We traveled to meet new groups and we made trade routes.
Judy et Peter montent une troupe de théâtre écologiste, le Rainhabitory Theater, dont le message poursuit l'esprit digger, choisir son engagement et agir à l'endroit où on vit. Ils jouent dans les communautés qui poussent ça et là. Le réseau s'étend à 300 communes qui proposent des services gratuits.
After the hippie scene got real serious and there was an anti-establishment movement and the war got serious and the left got serious and the government got serious. Well, when the action exploded in this riot, where was the leadership? Where's the diggers? Where are the diggers now that we need them?
The idea was to show the way. And I was really very disappointed when I discovered that some people will simply sit there with their hands out waiting, and they'll never pick it up for themselves. They just want a leader. We didn't want to be leaders. We just wanted to be pathfinders, guides, you know, signposts, flags. Follow this. But some people just wanted to be told what to do, wanted to be given written directions.
We'd really hope that there'd be a spontaneous, that the things that we were doing, people around us would see the reasoning behind what we were doing and understand why we were doing these things and make it part of their lives and go out and do these things themselves. A lot of that didn't happen, and that was to a small degree disappointing to a lot of us. But again, it was part of the educational process.
Right. The Diggers didn't feel it was their responsibility to lead anyone, which is interesting. I mean, it's interesting in terms of, it certainly inspires people to go and do something, but it means that you're irresponsible to its results. I'm a little worried about that one.
Well, I can't say that I ever tried to evade responsibility for my actions, or that my friends did. Maybe we tried to hide from the law. We thought of ourselves as guerrillas and warriors and stole a lot and performed a lot of criminal acts to feed people or shelter people or build houses or do things. But we thought the culture was our enemy and that we were outside it, and that was a kind of warfare.
Did not look like your run-of-the-mill flower child. I think we spent a lot more time in jail cells than most of the psychedelic leaders, as it were.
You shooting at that red can?
They got free food from people who would give it to them, and then they started to get more and more demand for the food, so you had to go and get it. And so you stole the food and brought it into the park. So if I go into the grocery store and I steal two pieces of steak and I feed my family, or I give them away, it's still, you're not disrupting capitalism or imperialism, you know? As Uncle Bert has said, you know, what's the difference of robbing a bank to founding of one?
But the Diggers never pretended to be doing something that they would do for the rest of their lives as a committed political activity. The only thing the Diggers said they were doing was life acting the theater of free. And it opened at a certain time and it closed at a certain time. Success and failure don't really mean anything there. It's like saying, did a play fail? Well, a play would fail if nobody came to it.
What the Diggers did was ran off stage and took their characters that they thought they were playing on stage into life and became life actors. And become the characters that they want to play, inventing themselves as they spin in a kind of super consciousness, Kantian metaphysical manner. They become their own imagination.
Le théâtre des Diggers parle à notre imaginaire. Leur obstination à vivre leurs rêves nous fascine. Billy Fritsch, poète biker, inspire Denis Hopper pour réaliser son film Easy Rider. Emmett Grogan écrit Ringo Levio. Ce récit enflammé et fantasmé de sa vie et des Diggers passe de main en main. Emmett meurt d'une overdose en 78, un 1er avril. Et le mythe continue. Un digger nous a dit « Il faut changer le monde en montrant comment il devrait être. On se fout de ce qui se passe réellement. On n'a pas utilisé la vérité, mais le mythe. Des gens ont fait des petites choses qui ont changé le monde. »
Well, we were a center. And all we wanted to do was change the world. And we did change quite a lot, actually. Certainly left some effects. I mean, they're all seeds. That's all you can really leave is seeds. And then they'll sprout and turn into something you would have never imagined. And better than you would imagine, I hope.
Starring here. Thank you, Dave, for coming here. Thank you, people, for being here. How the winds are borne by you. How the winds are borne by you. How the wind is borne. by you. But my extended family are the Diggers. And there's so many different branches. I think that there's an unbroken set of activities here that has been carried on by the Diggers, by all kinds of poets who have engaged an active dream life in reality. So it's a continuing process. And it lives by acts. It lives by doing. So I invite you to engage the street, to make it a conscious, human place, to take care of your extended family, which is everyone around you, and to bring joy into lives.
Food dot bombs and serving, come on down. Food dot at the end of hate, where the park begins. Tell those folks. Food dot bombs. Diggers of today, serving bacon soup and Katz's day-old bagel, saying get in the loop and have some soup. There's the Digger Feast Store, serving free food to draft dodgers, AWOLs fleeing the war, long-haired urban gorillas, come who may, the free frame of reference, the communication company, feeds the underground press, and no joke, lots of good smoke. And the Digger slogan, 1% free, returns to the community.
Take care. Yeah, tell everybody. Tell them it's time to die. It's a banquet down here.
Yeah, so Food Not Bomb started as a revolutionary organization, and our idea is to try to get out on the streets and communicate with as many people as possible. So to us, it was very, very important to have our sign and our literature and be out in the street and to be providing material aid and showing by example the fact that we can provide for people to live and to also get a radical message to as many people as possible.
I ain't camera right on.
So, hey, are you thinking about getting the Grateful Dead back together?
Absolutely. Oh, yeah, you bring Jerry Garcia back.
Okay. Now, this guy's a good man. This is Paladin, beautiful man. All right, yeah. Paladin, we're going to go up to a little hippie hill, man.
Hope for it.
Do they want a survival guide or a street spirit?
To distribute free food, but also to distribute information about social change, about movements trying to create a better world so that we don't have to be out here serving free food because people are hungry, but trying to agitate for a society in which everybody benefits.
I think I know dressing.
You understand me? I said you cannot serve.
I can't serve either.
No. Do I need it?
Yeah, okay, you're right.
It's against the law to feed homeless. It's against the law to sleep in the park. It's against the law for you to see me. I live outside. I'm a criminal. I live outside the law.
The Food Not Bombs people in particular are illegal. So there is a theater of giving away food and the police stopping the giving away of food. So they're much closer to the Diggers than, for example, the churches that give food.
The Diggers were a big inspiration for myself and for many people in Food Not Bombs. And the idea of free food, free clothing, free medical care is something that inspires many of us to keep trying to provide as many things free, but to not only provide things free in the sense of building a community of support, but also to provide things free in a public way that shows resistance to corporate dominance and other systems of oppression that keep people down and prevent people from having what they need for free.
I think the
I was a mailman then. I was the mailman on Haight Street. I worked for the post office. And I brought all the checks to the kids on acid, you know, from their mommy and daddy. And I was chosen because I had an apartment, a big flat right by the Panhandle, to if they would, they could use my kitchen. And then we would serve the soup in the Panhandle. The Panhandle in 66, 65 and 66. That's when I did it. That's a long time ago. And then after that, I then got into the theater and formed a theater troupe called the Angels of Light that also did free food, but at the performance that we did a big show and did food during the show. So it was a total experience. I'm just a continuing link because I was more into the theater than into cooking, but still cook, you know. We formed a nonprofit so that we could go to the food bank, you know, and get the food. You know, we formed it so that we could really have a lot of food. I work with Food Not Bombs, and they don't like to work with the feds, you know, or the federal government, and in any way. And so they don't have access to as much food. This is the leftover food from what we do in the morning. We serve 200 families in the Mission District of immigrant families, because many of the immigrant families were cut off. Food stamps, SSI, all of the welfare programs were cut. It pleases the people around me, you know, to do it. There was a need for it. You know, as I say, I've worked in soup kitchens before that are very hard and prison-like and dehumanizing. And I just wanted a more fun place to serve the food.
It is happening. It is happening wherever it wants to. It could be happening everywhere. I mean, it is usually the intersection of more than one mind that freely plays with another. It does require a certain amount of trust. But I think it can happen absolutely anywhere. Anytime, all you have to do is really let your mind go, trust another being, see what happens. Could be interesting.
There are a lot of things happening. I don't know whether I want to talk about that, though, because, again, I still feel that if you talk about things that are going on today, that in some ways you kill the magic of that. If somebody's really interested in to finding the diggers or to finding the spirit of the diggers, then they will find it. And they will find it in their lives. They will find other people who are doing it.
What do you get? I got nothing to sell. All I can do is give you my time and my body. And I'm sick of mine. I'll say, yeah, baby, no cause. What I stand for is people. And the poetry in people.
A lot of people who had been in San Francisco in the Bay Area, you know, and part of the hippie psychedelic and in some cases digger scene began to move. It's one of the places where people moving north found respite and found land. Some people bought land and a community started to be born.
We continued like we had our babies at home. We learned how to grow food. We learned how to take, it was that same thing of not wanting to go to the professionals, to the institutions. We wanted to do the things ourselves and have primary experience in our life. And that's how I think we got here. It's a continuation of wanting primary experiences in our lives.
And moving here to this particular valley, our sense of relationship expanded once again. And I would have to say this is important relative to bioregionalism. We learned here that our senses of community, as it were, could not be confined to people who had the same cultural experience. Our sense of community really had to be expanded to include everybody who we share the place with, and that's different. in order to be true to our perceptions about the right way to live on the planet Earth, we had to expand that sense to include, or to add to that sense, a loyalty and a commitment to the people all around us.
In this one, in this issue, yeah. Judy and I founded Planet Drum Foundation in 1973. And our idea was that the people of the planet needed a place where they could talk about living in bioregions interdependently. And we keep a volunteer network of 450 groups in the Bay Area. And when people call up, we can tell them about a group that's near them doing something that they want to do. And the idea of a bioregion as a place we all share is like a free zone. And the idea that bioregions should have their own government is autonomous. That decentralization of government is a better idea ecologically. Is very much like the digger idea that you should do your own thing where you live. So for me, the whole digger sentiment has gone into an ecological sentiment where people are part of the place where they live. People are part of nature, and nature is the subject.
While we were dancing in Haight Street, this was happening. All of this land was being cut. Vast amounts of soil being left exposed to enormous amounts of rain. The nature of the river changed completely in the floods of 1964. Right. No more urinating in the woods.
There, now they've done it.
How do a few people with small bodies, frail hands, do anything about it? Everyone thought it was impossible. Forget it, we were told. You're crazy. All right. So a very small group of people said, we have done crazy things before. We know how to approach things directly. Why not take this on?
We first began to work out in 1976. By 1980, the Mattole Salmon Group, it's called, was doing this small hatchbox program, enlist neighbor groups of people who live nearby the streams where we're trying to enhance the salmon run. So the salmon indicate the health of the whole country. That's one of the reasons why they're so important to us. The technologies involved in what we were doing were very simple, low-key, so local people could operate them. And the object was to get as many people involved as possible.
Reforestation, putting structure back in the aquatic habitat, erosion control. More and more we've begun to work directly with landowners, both inhabitory people and industrial people, on their land use practices, actually get involved with timber harvest projects.
I think we're being choreographed here.
Whatever the case may be, we ran into conflict with the timber industry and the people in the valley who identified with it, because it was inevitable. It was the point where our values were not reconcilable with some of the values of the people who lived here before us. And that conflict to a certain degree goes on. To some degree it's cultural, but the economic aspect of it is what makes it especially painful, because a lot of people see us as challenging their economics. There is a way, we are saying, to take from the land, to take what we need from the land that can be sustained ecologically, and that does not destroy the capacity of the land to support all the creatures. And that's what we try and do in our theater. We try to show the medium in which environmental damage is happening and to point towards ways out of it, point towards positive solutions.
The right, why does that give them the right to destroy everything?
Well, what is that supposed to mean, huh?
So in that sense, you know, our theater is, I hope, a vehicle for change.
To be free means you have to be responsible for yourself. This is one of the things that some people are still desperately fighting not to understand. And I think it's the only way we can ever get out of where we are, to go another step higher. All these free things belonged to us and belonged to whoever wanted them. But it had to be what you took, you were responsible for, whatever you wanted to do with it. But it became yours when you took it. And the fact that freedom and responsibility are two sides of the same thing seems still to be a mystery to many people. We did not totally succeed. However, we succeeded pretty well, at least for a while, and it was a wonderful, exciting feeling to see the world changing around us, to see people opening up, becoming aware of themselves. You never feel strong and you never feel sure of yourself. But if you take the freedom of being what you are and accept that it is beautiful, then you become free. And then, of course, you have to free others.
Notre humanité est une dignité à conquérir. C'est l'affaire de tous, et tous, c'est chacun. Nous ne voulons plus d'une société basée sur le travail et la production. Nous ne voulons pas non plus d'une société d'assistance. Nous voulons une société fondée sur l'entraide et l'autogestion. À nous de reprendre en main notre vie individuelle et collective. À nous de nous réapproprier les moyens matériels que les possesseurs des pouvoirs politiques, financiers et médiatiques nous ont volés. Reprenons tout. Notre désir est libre, la vie est gratuite, vivons nos rêves, soyons ce que nous sommes. Nous sommes vivants.
We come in peace, they said, to dig and sow. We come to work the land in common and to make the waste ground grow. This earth divided, we will make whole. So it shall be a common treasury for all. The sin of property we do disdain. No man has any right to buy and sell the earth for private gain. By theft and murder they took the land. Now everywhere the walls spring up at their command. They made the laws to bind us well. The clergy dazzle us with heaven, or they...